What a difference a day makes. The first day of what for me is the first day of 2018. So between going to bed in 2016, December 31st, 2016, I woke up in January 1st, 2018. How did that happen? So I welcome you all to 2018, actually. And you might be saying, oh. So, yeah. Yeah. I've said in many videos in the past that I would sidestep the troubles that are to come. And I'm advising everybody, sidestep the troubles that are to come. And so this is what has happened. I literally sidestepped 217. So this has to do with time, you know, the whole thing about time. The less deluded we are about time, because time doesn't exist at all, actually. The more willing we're to accept that time doesn't exist, what happens is we're able to do what I've been able to do through the grace of the Bodhisattvas. Bodhisattvas symbolized by Manjushri. I went to Manjushri yesterday and I said, okay, we'll play it your way. Let's play it your way. I emptied myself of all plans, ideas, ambitions, thoughts, everything. I just mentally prostrated myself to him and just lay quiet and it's your will. Whatever you want to do, it's okay with me. It's up to you. Then I woke up this morning and I realized I had been given an entire year of grace, meaning freedom from time for an entire year. It means that whatever happens in this dream of 217 is not going to touch me. It's not going to touch me at all. So Manjushri gave me an entire year of grace. Now this is wonderful for the world. The benefits to the world are tremendous, actually. Whether people realize it or not. Now, also, I was given the option, and I agreed to it, a 1 year silent intensive starting today, going through 1 year, and 1 year silent intensive. Now, I have to work out the details of all of this. But I will make my videos and what I do available to the public for this year, but I will not be dialoguing during the year. I won't be engaging in dialogue. The general parameters are that I will, like, for instance, on Facebook, I will not be going back and forth sharing pictures. I'll put my stuff up there. I'll put the grace of 218 up there. Okay. But it's going to be a silent sort of thing. Now, certainly the Dharma Kings may give some surprises. That's fine with me. The general parameters are there. And who knows what they will do. They're able to shift things, like the intensive, a silent intensive. I gave six full weeks, and now they've shifted it to a 1 year silent intensive because I was so successful in doing that intensive. They said, okay, you can handle a 1 year intensive. I said, okay, let's do it. Now, 216 was a 1 year intensive for me, really. In intensive, what I did in 216 was I blocked out the world for an entire year. Blocked it out like it never happened. For me, 216 really never happened. No news, no radio, no newspapers, no television, no movies, no magazines. I don't know what happened in 216 in the world. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all, actually. It's just a dream. It's a dream of limitations upon the mind which don't exist. It's a search for experience instead of experiencing. It's much ado about nothing, actually. And so I've already proven to myself I can do this. I can just let an entire year like it never happened. Ultimately, we get to the point where nothing ever happens in terms of time, space, process, and form. And that's ultimate liberation. Now, what I agreed to is to forego ultimate liberation for a year, okay, in exchange for getting at ease with total easement, getting at ease with easement. So total liberation is really just perfect at easement. So what I'm going to do for a year is to get familiar with easement, step by step by step by step by step, get familiar with it. I had to carry something really heavy and awkward up some stairs yesterday, at the end of the day. I was working yesterday, and I almost didn't do it, but I said, wow, I got to do this, but I'm afraid I'll injure my knee's not good right now. I'm afraid I'll injure myself. So I started climbing up the stairs, and I felt the pain in my knee. I said, uh-oh, I'm going to get injured here. So I said, what do I do? And suddenly, I said, let me try this. And I lifted this heavy object, bulky object, and I set it on the stairs up above me. I used my upper body strength and core strength. And then I rested on the stairs, and then I stepped with my legs onto the next step without any weight on me. And so I did this each step of the stairs and was able to get to the top of the stairs without any problem for my knees. And then I had to lift it up on a shelf, and that took just a full body strength to do this, and I was able to do it. So it means I'm strong enough. If I use skillful means, I'm strong enough. We have to use skillful means, not heroic means right now. Now, I once came across a book that had the birthdays, dates of like last 100 years. If you were born on this date, what is your characteristics? They've done astrological profiles for everybody, some kind of profiles. And mine was that you're going to either be a successful brain surgeon or a successful gambler. And so I said, wow, that's pretty accurate. I've actually done both. Brain surgeon means I'm successful at mental health and a successful gambler. And the key to being a successful gambler is to know when not to gamble. Okay. Know, as Kenny Rogers, the gambler song says, you got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run. You don't count your winnings when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. Okay, when the dealing's done. It's very, very apt lyrics. So to be a super successful gambler, you have to know when not to gamble. And 2017 is a year not to gamble. Not to gamble. Okay, now, some more wowish sharing here. I woke up this morning and I decided to make this move, and I checkmated the ego. So the ego is in checkmate. If you know chess, that when you're in checkmate, the match is over. Checkmate. So I checkmated the ego. The match is over. It's finished. But the shock of checkmating the ego is not finished. Do you get this? And I hope you do, because this is what I've been aiming for, to get everyone to understand the shock, the wow, and having to block the shock so it doesn't go into panic. So I need to spend this quote-unquote year of grace. Year of grace for me is to just get used to the shock of having, you know, checkmated the ego, put the ego in checkmate. Which means getting at ease with easement. Getting at ease with easement. That's for me. That's what it'll be. Getting at ease with easement. So I won't be enlightened this year, so to speak. I won't be enlightened. The choice was I could try for enlightenment in 2017, or I could accept a year of grace where I could get at ease with easement, which is the sure way, the certain way. So imagine if somebody, they say a bird in a hand is worth two in the bush, right? Imagine if someone gave you a choice, and they said you could strive for enlightenment this year, or you could have a year of grace where you could get used to the fact that you are going to be enlightened, but you're not going to be enlightened in this year. But it's a sure thing. But you just won't be enlightened in this year. Okay, what would you take? So I said, well, you have to look at the year. what's going on? And as I looked at 217, and I said, wow, it's no time to gamble. 217 is no time to gamble. This is when to play it safe. So this is a really, really great gambling move, you see. You know when to play it safe. So I said, I'll take the year of grace. So I'll be patient for a year. No full enlightenment, total enlightenment, so to speak. No liberation for that year, but that's okay because I'm taking the sure thing. So this is the right example to set for others because 217 is not a year to gamble. There may be some that do gamble, but it's very reckless indeed to do that. Because you're putting losing on the table also. Okay, when you gamble, the whole thing about gambling is it's the reason why it's so addictive, it's adrenaline, it's a thrill, because losing is an option also, right? What I'm doing is I'm taking losing off the table. So no gambling. There's no possibility of me losing. It's a year of grace, already guaranteed me by the Bodhisattva Manjushri. So I can't lose. Now, those who are addicted to gambling, the kick of it, the thrill of it, they might say, I wanted to gamble. It's really a great opportunity to get this, mega thrill of gambling. Super mega thrill. Yeah, they want the super mega thrill of gambling. And I said, no, I'm going to take the conservative, cautious approach and sit in the wow for one more year. I'll do the wow for one more year. How about that? So I'm committed to the wow for one more year. And some of you may be breathing a big sigh of relief and saying, wow, that is great. That is truly great. Because we're just not ready for the full-blownness, right? That's right. 217, it's not a year to gamble on. Are you ready? Are you ready for like Rama Maharshi, for instance? No, we're not quite ready. Right? We're not quite ready. We're not quite there. And I realized that a couple days ago. It was amazing everything that's been happening. It's just like orchestrated. Perfectly orchestrated. I realized I'm not quite ready for the big time. Because I'm not at ease with easement yet. I see the easement. I'm aware of the easement, but I'm not at ease with the easement. Do you get this? So I get a year to be at ease with the easement, and you get also a year to get the flavor of all of that. And you can say, hey, I'm not gambling this year either. I'm going to participate in a year of grace. All right. And you can work on blocking out 217 more and more and more and more and just pay no attention to it because you know I'm going to be here in 218 with the flavor of 218, right? As if 217 never happened. So you may stagger across the finish line December 31st, 217, and you may be bloodied and beat up and just, really thrashed, like a big wave has just pounded you. But there's a jet ski there to pull you onto the beach, and you get onto the beach, and you'll recover, and you say, wow, yeah, I'm okay. So I'm not out in the big waves. I have a jet ski, so to speak, rescuing those who are getting pounded by the waves, something like that. There's a plan, and part of this plan is a rescue. And so I'm not even in 217, actually. In it, but not of it, so to speak. I'm appearing here. I still have an appearance here, but I'm not in the time of 217 at all. I'm not in that time frame. I've bypassed it, skipped it, skipped a year. So this gives everyone an opportunity to back off a little bit. One second here. Okay. Happy 217. There is no 217 for me, actually. So this is my plan. You know, in the back of my mind, I said, I know I'm going to sidestep the trouble somehow. I don't know how, but it's going to happen. That's my destiny to do that. And so we're starting to find out how it's done now. How it's done. It's already been done. It's already done, but it's now just staying in stride, and enjoying it. I leave the logistics to the bodhisattvas. That's their job. My job is just to agree to it. Their job is to arrange the logistics. Now, as far as parameters of where I wanted to be right now, I'm right where I want to be. The knee is not good because I pushed it, and I understand why I pushed it. And mentally now, I'm in such a great place, the knee's going to get fine. It's going to be fine, better than fine. I understand what was going on there. The parameters of this day, I said I wanted to hit a certain weight, a certain fitness capability, a certain weight. I wanted to see, can I handle this year of grace, year of easement, because it requires me to be in really good shape. Strong enough to get through it. And yes, I weighed myself last evening, the evening of the 31st, and I was like almost 3 pounds overweight. And I said, uh-oh, this is really bad. Because I had been just drinking just one smoothie for the whole day. And I said, wow, I should be lower. But then I said, well, you know, I lose weight overnight, so let's see what I am in the morning. But I wasn't sure I was going to make it. I felt, this isn't good. Well, I got jumped on the scale this morning praying, and I came in underweight. I lost 3 pounds between last night and this morning. 3 pounds of weight. It's just like a miracle. I made it. So it's very important. It's kind of a goal that I've had that sort of symbolizes how dedicated I am, and the ability to reach a goal on time. You know, in other words, at the right moment, to be at the right place at the right moment, and I was able to do it. I was able to do 10 push-ups yesterday also, which was quite extraordinary. My body was just so sore last night, just beaten up. I mean, I said, man, I just can't work out right now. I am so thrashed. But I feel better today, and it's going to get better and better and better and better. So right fitness, right weight, right mental shape, right state of grace. Everything is right, and the knee will get better now because I assured it, okay, knee, I get what you were telling me. I get it. I accept it. And the knee was saying, back off. Don't try to go for it all in 217. Can you take one more year of patience of wow? And I said, yeah, I can do that. It's, you know, I committed for another year of wow. So at the very first, you know, in the morning of the first, I committed to another year of full stop in the wow practice. Instead of saying, no, okay, I'm gonna be enlightened in 217 and really hit the big time. No, I'm going to stay humble, stay low, another year of full stop in the wow practice. But under the grace of I'm actually practicing it in 218. So for me, it's like 217 is already done, and it never happened. It's like that. Never happened. We don't need it to happen, do we? We don't need it. We don't need any time to happen, ultimately. But we'll take a year of time not happening as a starter. It's like a hors d'oeuvre, right? It's like, why not? Let's start with that. Let's start with the year. Let's not get greedy. So I said, oh, yeah, let's not get greedy. Let's take the sure way, not the greedy way, not the macho way, okay? The macho and the matcha are two sides of one coin. There's a lot of matcha in the world right now, which is pushing us men to be very macho, and it's also a very rebellious time of teenage, adolescent phase. The world is going through a very much an adolescent, rebellious phase right now. And I've said I'm like a 12-year-old. My mind's like a 12-year-old. I'm not going into the teens. I decided I'm not going into them. I already did that. Been there, done that. I know what it's all about. The whole thing. I backtracked and I said no. I'm wearing a pair of pants right now. It says 1969 on the pants. A pair of Levi's, 1969. And in 1969, I was 12 years old. I was 12 years old, by my counting. At least I was up until August. So I was a preteen. So these pants symbolize preteen. And preteens still love their parents, so to speak. Okay, this is very significant. You can tell the difference between a teenager and a preteen is the preteens still listen to their parents. They still take the advice of the parents. They still accept the authority of the parents, so to speak. And this is a metaphor for God. Is when we're in this preteen mental state, we still accept the grace of God. We still accept the advice of God, the authority of God, through the Dharma Kings, through the Holy Spirit and the grace of God. And we do what they say. If they say, hey, don't do that, we say, okay, all right, you know better. Whereas a teenager won't say that. They'll say, why? And they'll sneakily do it anyway, right? Totally different attitude. So what we have in the world is this teenage attitude, okay? And so what I did was I opted to not be a teenager. Pretty cool, huh? For me, it's really cool. It's really great. So the teenagers will say, wow, we're teenagers, we're better than you. And I say, yeah, well, you're gambling and I'm not gambling, okay? I've already gambled. I'm a super gambler and I'm gambling on not gambling right now. And I know that's the winning way, no doubt about it. So I have this very youthful kind of attitude, preteen attitude, which comes from Manjushri. Manjushri is this eternal youth. Gentle glory is, Manjushri means gentle glory, and he's always been experienced throughout history as this eternal youth. Preteen youth, okay, young, preteen. That's Manjushri. So that's what I'm about. And the 12-year-old doesn't lose their clarity. They see, when you get into adolescence, you get into this commotion, which people like commotion. We want, you know, we're chasing after commotion. In fact, this whole dream is a dream of commotion. And the instant we decided for commotion, the dream of commotion, that very instant we started the dream of commotion, right then. There was not some intermediary instant where between deciding on commotion and experiencing commotion. The deciding of to experience commotion and the experiencing of it arise simultaneously. So we keep trying to find some moment where in between where we decided for commotion but we didn't experience it yet. There's no such moment. There's no such moment. There's no such moment. To find such a moment would be to find that reality isn't real. And reality is real. So the instant we decided to experience commotion, we experienced commotion. There was no I first and then commotion. So the experiencing of commotion arose instantaneously. Instantaneously. There was no delay. So we keep looking for some delay. It doesn't exist. And so the teenage rebellious phase is rebelling against this reality, saying, no, 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 we can find it. We'll find it. You know, we're adventurous teenagers, you know. So 217 may be more adventure than some of you teenagers want. And so come on back to being a 12-year-old. Yeah, I'm here. I'll be a 12-year-old in 218 also. I already am in 218 as a 12-year-old. So I'll still be here in 218 as a 12-year-old. Of course, a 12-year-old has to have a healthy body to be a 12-year-old, carefree and flexible. I was watching this 12-year-old surfer. Interesting that this video on Magic Seaweed of this 12, best 12-year-old surfer in the world. This guy may be the best 12-year-old surfer in the world. I believe it said 12-year-old. And he was in like Java, I think, or yeah, and he was really, really good. And I said, wow, I mean, he's just having a blast. I mean, and I said, this 12-year-old, this kid is just having fun, and he's surfing great. What's wrong with that? I mean, do you really need to be like a 25-year-old? Really? I mean, why? If you can surf like that at 12, you know, he's not surfing Jaws, Chapu or Jaws or Nazare or, you know, the super wide, you know, pipeline, the real dangerous stuff that can kill you. So he's surfing these, but he's still surfing these beautiful waves and just getting absolutely barreled and just tearing it up and just laughing and styling and just having a blast. He's having a blast. He's getting, maxing out all that fun. So that's good enough for right now, isn't it? Sure it is. Sure it is. Interesting, right? Interesting synchronicity there. As I'm constantly adjusting the levels here, as the light changes and shifts. So another year of full stop in the WoW. No worries. More videos for you. More videos for you. Since I've committed to this now, and you know what's going on, I can open it up. Can open it up. So it'll be very interesting for you to be have contact with someone who's already in 2018. Very interesting indeed. What can I do with this lighting on this? It's very challenging. Let me see. What do I do? Back off this, back off that. There you go. Well, we're just making adjustments. We'll make adjustments. So it's a unique opportunity for you to have contact with somebody who's already in the what you would say your future. Okay. And this starts to play with the whole notion of time, really, which is what we need to do. Jesus said time is the greatest illusion. It causes us the greatest trouble. Nothing's even close. That's the big one. So he said, really, you need to focus on freeing yourself from the delusion of time. Let that be a real great focus for you. So this is a terrific opportunity to do just that. Pretty amazing, huh? Very amazing. Very wowish, which is what we're used to. We're used to hearing the videos. It's all been very wowish, and I told you it would get more, much more so going forward, and it already has, hasn't it? Much more so. And so, but we need not stress out. We'll, you know, pace ourselves properly here. Pace ourselves properly. No hurry. But go briskly. Go briskly. Not too fast. I was walking down these dangerous stairs, and this little girl, it was just like, I don't know, she was very small, tiny. She was running down these stairs. I said, oh, holy cow, that's how I almost injured myself, really, is running down those stairs. And I was almost wanted to call out and say, hey, be careful, don't go too fast. But she was right on the edge. She didn't go too fast, but, you know, she handled it just right. And then she came down to the stop, and then she started running back up. I said, ah, that's the play of grace showing me something. Go fast, but not too fast. So she was showing me that even as a little child can run down the stairs. But they were sensible, and I was going too fast. I was trying to show off, you know, like a teenage thing, like, look how great I am. And I almost fell badly, and I hurt my knee in some way. I think that contributed to it. But I was taping at the same time, and it was a dangerous situation, actually. I was going way too fast. So I have to back off. I realize I have to back off. I'm not quite ready for full power yet. Not quite ready for full power. So some might say, you know, hey, full power mode. Come on, go in. No, I don't say that at all. I say this year we're not going to go into full power mode. Okay, we're going to go into full grace mode. Full grace mode. Getting at ease with easement. We're going to get at ease with easement. So I'll have the easement of having skipped 217, and you'll have that available to you. You'll have that available to you. So when things get, you know, how are they getting in your time frame of 217, you'll say, wait a minute, I already have access to 218, so to speak, right? And you'll be able to tune in to 218. Now, there'll be videos, there'll maybe graphics, and maybe SoundCloud, maybe audio recordings, which some find that that's helpful for them. And you can, you know, download those. I imagine you can, to MP3s. You can have it on MP3 player as you drive, as you jog, as you work out, as you go about your day. You can listen on an MP3 recording. Which I understand this could be very handy for a lot of you, actually, who are active. So, I have a good recorder arriving. It's supposed to arrive maybe Wednesday. So, that's coming up in about maybe three or four days. It's supposed to arrive. We'll see. And it's supposedly supposed to make very good audio recordings. Whereas this is okay. It's okay, but I have some problems with the recorder. This thing is portable. It's a hand carry with your hand. I can do it anywhere. So I can make recordings on the fly anywhere. I'll just have it like a backpack and just be able to make recordings for you. And so you'll be able then to, I don't know how much space I have on SoundCloud is the only problem. So I don't know if I'll be able to, you know, keep all the recordings there or not. We'll see how that goes. But it's just it's another option, right? Where if you're on the go, you'll be able to tune in on the go, to 218. How about that? So you'll be able to, in 217, you'll have the option to be able to tune in to 218. Already tune into it. How about that? How amazing! What a great grace it is. Thank Manjushri for this awesome gift of an entire year of grace. Most people, they pray for like a moment of grace. I didn't pray for anything. I said, whatever you want to give me, I'll accept. That's it. I'll do it your way. Now, that's like a 12-year-old, right? I'll do it your way. Okay. I'll do it the way of those who know best. And instead of giving a day of grace, Manjushri gave me a year of grace, an entire year. I was just like, wow. So we'll get used to powering up, but we won't go full power. We won't go full power. Unless the Dharma Kings, you know, accelerate things if they want to. But I'm committed to a full year. It's not a problem. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. It's a blessing for me. It's a blessing for everyone. It will take the edge off of your 217. It'll take the edge off of it. A lot of people think, well, I'm going to have to fight it out. And now you're thinking, like, wait a minute. Maybe I don't have to fight it out. Maybe I can spend, you know, tune into 218. That's an option I have. Huh. So, you know, so you're going to kind of start assessing your options here. But I won't be in 217. I won't be dragged into 217 at all. It's already gone for me. Like it never happened. Just like 216 was mostly totally gone for me, never happened. But the not happening of 216 happened, which was amazing. It was great. Best non-year I've ever had. It's like not having a year was much better than having a year. Just like ultimately not having a life is way better than having a life. A life. Because all, really, we are eternal life. Eternal life doesn't have a life. It doesn't have a bunch of lives. It's continuously smooth. There's no separation between lives or anything like that. It's all just one smooth eternal life. And so we're just, you know, easing in to this total easement. We're easing into total easement. Now it's cold here in California. We're having some, you know, cool, chilly, blustery weather. It's beautiful, but cool. And you expect that the first. That's fine. Although, I prefer sunnier climates. Especially being outside a lot. So, this has thrown a wonderful monkey wrench into the entire situation. A wonderful option, right? It's thrown a monkey wrench into the ego's plans. Like I say, this is checkmate for the ego. And the ego knows this, which is okay, because I got permission to do this. The world gave me permission to checkmate the ego. Because it trusted that I would do it in an easy way, you know. Which is what we're doing. We want to ease out. We want to ease into easement. We want to ease into easement. We want to ease into easement. Or so, that's what we will do. We will ease into easement. So I will make available that which helps ease into easement in some way. There may be other ways that I'm not aware of, actually. There may very well be other ways. So representing the spirit of 218 as 217 begins, is really representing the spirit of timelessness, isn't it? If you look at it deeply, it really is. So we're going to have 1 year of getting used to a representation of easement with timelessness. We're going to ease in to the easement of timelessness, which is eternal life, actually. But we're going to have an entire year to ease in, work on this easement, all right? And the more you work at it, of course, the better it'll go for you. You get out of it what you put into it. This is something that's very important. You have to realize it is, you know, just a click on Facebook, like for one instant, and then off the next thing. Well, you get out of it what you put into it. So you get a click, and you get a click. But here, we're putting time into it, or we're putting, quote-unquote, our moments into it. Our moments. We're our effort, our attention, all of that. When you put your effort and attention and moments onto easing into timelessness, you get that back. You yourself will then feel an ease with timelessness, which is the goal. We want that feeling of easement with it, with timelessness. Have to get that. Have to get it. So, be a workaholic in this regard. And put that ahead of everything else. Make it your goal. Make it your goal. Meaning, you have to do it. Like, I made goals, and like a weight goal. I had to reach this weight. For over a year, I've had this on my mind. By this date, I had to be a certain weight, and it was so difficult. I mean, I just kept fluctuating. I kept going a little bit above, and I was like right in the ballpark for a long time. But I was like about a couple pounds overweight. I couldn't seem to get it down any further. You know, I touched upon it a few times. It's really tough for me to reach that weight, but. Being as that it's a very important goal, I just refused to give up on it and said, you know, I'm just not going to give up, which meant I couldn't go binge eating. I said, no, I just can't do it. It's too important for me. Many opportunities arose. People keep offering, hey, why don't you just give up? You know, you get great try, you know, but why put yourself through all this torture? You know, people do this to you, right? You want to stay away from such people, where failure is an option for them, you see. For me, failure's off the table. The ego's already been checkmated. It's it. It's finished. Finished. So, I had to just say, no, that's enough of that. I got to back off. After Christmas, I was like 5 pounds overweight. Almost six. Actually, I was like, yeah. Really over more than 5 pounds, 5.5 pounds overweight, what I wanted to hit after Christmas. And I said, uh-oh, how can I possibly make it in 1 week, you know, to the new year? I said, wow, this is really amazing. But it just backed off the eating, bit by bit, backed off. And yesterday I really backed off a lot and made it. But I never would have made it if I had given up and really thrown on the towel and said, like, if I had 5 pounds already, said, oh, I can never make it, so what the heck? Let me just forget about it. No, I said, no. Even if I miss, I want to do my best effort to make it. Okay? If I miss, I miss, but it's not for lack of trying. You see, I'm going to keep trying. And this is what did the job. This is what turn the tide for me. So this is the whole key to success at any intensive, is you never give up. You say, no, I'm going to do the very best I can all the way through. And if I don't make it, it will not be because I haven't given everything I've got. I'll take whatever results there are. Okay, but I'm going to give my best effort. This is really, vitally important to have this attitude. Now, this whole opportunity was presented in a certain way to me, very interesting way. There's a lot of background to it, but a great analogy. I use golf as a wonderful analogy. It's really very vibrant analogy to use. And it was put to me like this. It says, how would it be to... Yesterday it says, how would it be, don't hit your driver for a while, just don't hit it, just play a whole round of golf with your four wood. I said, wow, that's a huge wow for me, like, oh my gosh, really? And so I thought about it, and I said, well, you know, that would be really interesting to do. So I started getting used to the notion of maybe that's something I could do. Yes, this video, shifty thing here, isn't it? Let me bop this down a little bit and bump this up. And I got used to it. I got used to that notion. I have to bump it up a little more. I didn't say yes. Okay, don't say yes. When you get an offer, don't say yes and don't say no. Just say, wow, that's a really interesting idea. Just play an entire round of golf, no driver. You committed. You're not going to hit the driver. And then this morning I said, you know, it would be better to just not have the driver in the bag at all, because the temptation is going to be there, right? I just have to take it out of the bag. I said, huh. But then I said, but still, I'm not supposed to hit the driver, because there's reasons for that. It's a very interesting situation that's going on. I understand it. So then it was presented to me, how would it be to just take the driver out of your bag for 2017, the whole year? Just don't have it in your bag for a whole year. It's like, wow, that is so audacious to think in that way. But I love audacity like that. Very audacious idea. So I just, for like an hour or two, I just sat there in bed and just saying, wow. I love the audacity of that. take it out, and for an entire year, I'm not even going to have the driver in my bag for an entire year. Which means a lot. But the idea is so amazing. I said, wow, I'm going to consider that. I'm really going to consider this. I like that style of audacity. I say, well, don't just take it out for a day. Take it out for a year. So I really worked on that, and that led to understanding the bigger picture of it all. And I said, well, I'll have to really crush the forward then. Yeah. So I'll have to get really good at just crushing the forward. And I can do that because I went out and practiced, I think it was 2 days ago. That's been on my mind. It's very important. And I was able to show myself I can crush it. I did crush it. The last one I hit, I crushed it perfectly. And I said, wow, that's just as good as a driver, the way I hit it that one. I mean, that one went a long, long ways. I said, I can do it. I can do it. So I know I can do it. Now, what does taking the driver out of your bag symbolize? Abundance of caution, playing it safe. In other words, not gambling. It's a time to not gamble. Because a driver symbolizes potential for big winnings, also the potential for big losses. Okay. In other words, if you have the driver and you're crushing it, you have a chance to really crush the course and get a real low score. You know, you can be the boss. But it also brings into play the possibility you can have a disastrous round, a really disastrous round. So I know this from 44 years of golf. I know this is true. This is very true. Now, I asked Manjushri a couple dates ago, what do you want me to do? And then right away I saw this license plate that said Flying Tiger. And I got it immediately. I said, do you want me to fly like Tiger Woods? The whole thing is pivoted towards golf now. It's really amazing. And I said, oh my gosh, you're really serious about this, huh? So and then I said, well, how did Tiger Woods fly so high? You know how he did it? I know how he did it. Because he could crush the 3-wood and a 2-iron. And he stayed away from his driver. He stayed away from danger. He stayed away from disaster. Okay? Like at the British Open, he won it. He just devastated the field. Never even hit a driver, I think. Never even, maybe hit it one time. Maybe he didn't hit a driver the entire time. I think maybe it was once in the 4 rounds. He just put it away. He said, I'm not hitting driver, and he didn't. And he just devastated it with a 3-wood and a 2-iron. And his specialty is a stinger 2-iron. In like the U.S. Open, he he'd hit his like 2-iron like 290 yards, just dead straight, yeah, just low, just this low, stinging shot. And he stayed out of trouble doing that. And where other people would have to hit their drivers, and they would go in the rough. You know, they'd air by like 2 yards. Where so Tiger would be in the fairway, and this competitor would be in the 2 yards in the rough. But then Tiger would have this clean shot into the green, whereas the other guy would have to be hitting out this heavy rough. And so he'd get it close to the pin. The other guy would be farther away. He'd make birdie. They'd make, you know, par or something like that. So he knew, you know, that 1 or 2 yards is the difference between winning and losing. So his 2-iron would give him that accuracy that the others didn't have. Plus, he had the strength to hit it really far. So it was, you know, brilliantly disciplined strategy that he had. And it worked to perfection. Jack Nicklaus did the exact same thing. He relied on his 2-iron. Where other guys were hitting drivers, he'd hit a 2-iron. He was very disciplined that way. So that's really the key to Nicklaus and Tiger Woods' success. When conditions got really dangerous, they didn't gamble. They didn't gamble. Now, guys like Phil Mickelson, Greg Norman, they always gambled, and they lost. They lost. Like Greg Norman's a great example of how many majors did he gamble away. Many, many, many. Phil Mickelson, the same thing. They hit driver where they shouldn't have hit driver. Mickelson at Wingfoot, I think it was Wingfoot, New York, had the U.S. Open in his hand, and he hit driver off the 18th where he didn't need to. All he needed to do was hit a 2-iron or 3-wood, just lay up his drive like 250 or something, and just hit an iron on the green and get a par, and he's won. Instead, he tries to kill a driver, hits it out of bounds on top of the hospitality tent, bogeyed the hole away, and I think got in a playoff and he lost. It was just ridiculous. You know, I say, how could you do that? Because he's a gambler. Phil Mickelson is actually a gambler, very much a gambler. He gambles with money in his life. He's a gambler. But he's not a great gambler because he didn't know when not to gamble. You see, great golfer, but he has a flaw, whereas Tiger Woods did not have that flaw. I guarantee you Tiger Woods would have taken an iron off that tee and said, hey, par wins the U.S. Open. I'm making par for sure here. I'm not going to try and birdie the final hole. I've got par in hand. Come on. So play like Tiger plays and make sure you make par. Okay, so par is a great score in 217. That's what you want to win. To win. Okay, you've got it. Don't gamble it away. So for me, I'm not going to gamble it away. I'm going to play par golf now. So what hitting a four-wood does is it gives you much greater accuracy than a driver. Much greater accuracy. So even your bad shots aren't going to be nearly as disastrous as they would be with a driver. So it's all about playing it safe. It's all about playing it safe. Now, I with my fitness, I prove to myself I can crush a forward. I can get it out there. And so I can still play just fine. But the disastrous shots are very much marginalized. Okay, it's taken out of the equation to a very large extent. It's still possible you can hit a terrible shot if you really mess it up. But the odds are way in your favor. Way in your favor. If you push one badly, it's going to stay in bounds. If you push a driver badly, it's going out of bounds. I mean, pushing a driver badly, you might be errant like another 30 yards errant more, you know, like that. Really much more, 20 to 30 yards more of errancy means out of bounds, whereas if you push it real bad at the forward, you're still in play, you see. So the disasters are largely, especially for a whole round of golf, you could say disasters are taken out of the equation. The best round of golf I ever played was I hit just 5-wood off of the tee, 5-wood. It was a short course. And I posted a great score. I played safe. It was easy. Easy. The whole round was easy. I never did that again. But because I went and said, oh, if I can do that, let me crush the course, and went back to a driver. So what we want is easement. So hitting a 4-wood off the tee makes the round of golf easy. It makes it easy. You just kind of sail through it, you know. You're not crushing the course, but you're just easing your way through it. And I said, you know what, I'll do that for a year. I'll do that for a year. That's an amazing commitment on my part. It's an astonishing commitment. I'm shocked by it, you know. I'm shocked by it. Wow. Of course, I only played golf like twice last year, so that's pretty easy. Just don't play. I may play more this year, though. It's possible. I don't know. So I said, what an audacious thing to do. So just keep it easy the whole way. Easy, but no crushing of the course. No crushing of the courses. That's okay. But that then causes me to raise the rest of my game to a higher level by having to hit 3 hybrids, 4 hybrids, 5 hybrids, and I, you know, having to hit those because the drives won't be out there quite as far. I'm going to need to hit the mid irons, be really good with those mid distance shots. But that raises your game to a higher level to be able to do it that way. And then after that year, maybe I can add the driver because I have so much confidence in the ease of the golf game that adding the driver may just be a piece of cake. I don't know. Possible. Very possible, right? But that's the smart way to do it. That's the smart way to do it, is take the gamble out of it and gain your confidence in easy golf. Because what really kills people is when the driver gets erratic, and it kills their love of the game. It kills the round. It just kills their spirit. It demoralizes them. It's just like their mind is just all fragmented because they're chasing the glory. You know, they're chasing the glory. So let's take the glory out of the equation. Okay, and let's just chase easement in 217. For you, chasing easement. So since I committed to it, I've already done it. You see, I've already done it. And I'll just walk with you through 217, your 217. But for me, I'm in 218. I've already done it. Since I agreed to do it, when you agree to do it, it's already done. And you know, I'm one of the few that will do this. It's very audacious to do this. People recognize me when I was young as being, you're very audacious. Almost too much. They say, wow, I don't know what you're going to be like when you get older. Well, now you know. I'm skipping an entire year of time. Now, I could have gone bad, you know. let me open this up. This, what is this? Lemon lime sports drink. Great. Wow. Very nice. I could have gone bad, you know. I definitely could have gone bad. I almost did. I flirted with going bad. But then the grace of the Dharma Kings pulled me through. I said, well, I want to be sure that not going bad is the right thing. And then I saw it is. Not going bad is the right way to play it. It's the right way to play it. It's the right way to play our hand. So the audacity has worked out in the right way for us. Thank God for that and all those who have supported me over the years. Not knowing what would come of me. They really just didn't know. Said, wow, I don't, he's such a gambler. You know, what's he gambling on? I don't know. gambling on the Dharma Kings, which is a sure thing. In other words, I'm gambling on a sure thing, which most people don't believe that's possible. There is no sure thing, they think. And I'm saying, no. I'm gambling that there is a sure thing. There is a mental clarity we can have, which is unassailable. I'm sure of this. I've experienced it. Totally unassailable. So when we talk about mental health, the real goal of mental health is to accept the fact that our mind is unassailable, actually. Dreams do not assail our mind at all. So the dream of a dream mind being assailed by dream troubles is not really assailing our mind at all. It's not. And I've experienced this and I've seen it, and the Dharma Kings say that this is absolutely true, and they're telling us the truth. They're right. So that goal is there for all of us. We can get to that, and we will get to it by ultimately realizing we're already there. Okay, we never left it. We never left it. We get to it by realizing we never left it. But we have to ease into this checkmate. I've already checkmated the ego. Delusion is checkmated. But now I have to get over the shock of that. I have to have a lot of help blocking panic on this issue. So I will. Manjushri says, we'll give you a whole year of grace. I said, what are you going to do for me, Dharma Kings? My life seems to be run into a dead end. You know, it really is really at a dead end, but I didn't panic. I almost did, but my training has been so good that I said, no, we'll play it your way. I'm going to keep trusting in you. That I just say thank you for the tremendous job you've done to save me. Just without knowing how they're going to do it, I just said, I know it's already done. You've already done it. So instead of panicking, I had gratitude. I said, wow, as if I've already experienced what they've done for me. And I said, wow, you've just done a fabulous job. Thank you so much. It's just wonderful. And I just had this so much love and gratitude for what they've already done for me. In this way, I was able to block the panic. That's called skillful means, very skillful means. You know, most would not be audacious enough to do that. They'd say, well, I got to wait and see what they do for me. I said, no. I'm positive you've already done it for me. Because when they say they're going to save you, it's already done. Because they've already provided everything we need for it, the Dharma Kings. It's already done. So I just accept it. It's already done for me. Checkmate. That's it. And they will do everything that's necessary to block the panic of this checkmate move, which I made on time. I checkmated time is what I did. So that's already done. And now I'm in the phase of blocking the shock of this audacious move. It's very, very much so. But I'm used to that. I'm used to being very, very audacious. So for most in the world, you're not quite that audacious. I understand that. I've not really come across this type of audacity in others. I've come across, you know, everyone has varying degrees of audacity in relation to time, you know, and checkmating it. There's different degrees. Everybody's slightly different. So, from other standpoint, they view me as like, wow, you know, that might be a little too audacious. I don't know. I can't quite do that. You know, I'm not going to quite do that. Well, that's fine. I understand that. It's just been my destiny, and I've worked at it with great determination, you know, so I can do this. I'm able to do this, and I've done it. I've already done it. So I don't wait for permission to do it. I've already done it. It's already done. That's audacity. Because the Dharma Kings gave me permission. So I it's like a 12-year-old says, well, my parents gave me permission to do this, and I'm going to accept their permission. Whereas, you know, teenagers who are in rebellion saying, I don't care what kind of permission my parents give me, you know. I'm not going to do it their way. I'm going to do it my way. And they rebel. Whereas the 12-year-old will say, no, it's okay for me to do this because my parents gave me permission to do this. So that's why I'm doing it. It's the right thing to do. Teenagers will say, well, whatever my parents say, I'm going to go against it. You see, that's very gamblish and reckless, isn't it? Attitude, very rebellious attitude. Very dangerous attitude to have in 217. Extremely risky and dangerous attitude to have. So I'm attracting everyone back to this 12-year-old type of attitude where I do what my Dharma King parents tell me to do. And they said, checkmate time. Accept a year of grace. I said, okay, you give me permission to do it, I do it. It's done. It's already done. It's obedience. So I'm being obedient to the Dharma Kings, right? It's obedience. 12-year-old obedience. I'm looking at the rebellious teenager and say, yeah, you know, okay, you're okay. It's not like I'm, you know, hating on them or anything, but I just say, no, I'm not going there. That's all. And I said, even if nobody else does what I do, I'm still doing it. I've already done it. And I didn't get permission from anyone in the world to do this. Not a single person in the world did I get permission to do this, actually. Okay. I got permission from the Dharma Kings to do this. Like from my parents. So you know like how it is in teenage years. Like if you keep doing what your parents tell you to do, the teenagers will jeer you and mock you and bully you. Like, what's the matter with you? You're not part of our clique. You're not part of our group. You know, we're doing our own thing, you know? We're doing our own thing. That's the teenage years, right? You remember the teenage years, or you may be in the teenage years, or you understand exactly what I'm saying. So will I be a lonely teenager? No, because I'm not a teenager. So the fact that teenagers may ostracize me, say, that's okay, I'm not a teenager, so it doesn't bother me. I got the Dharma Kings to relate with. And they'll say, well, you'll never grow up. I say, well, I've already been grown up, been there and done that, and now I'm back to being a preteen. I prefer that. It's the right move to make. Because ultimately, the move to make is, of course, easement with the fact that time never started at all. There's never been any time. So I'll be a zero-ager at some point, right? Yeah, zero-ager. So by not having a driver in my bag, that takes the pressure off of me. Okay, it takes the pressure off of me. You see that, how great it is? So if I'm not crushing the course, it's like, well, because I don't have my driver, you know. If I had my driver, I'd be tempted by the teenagers to try to crush the course because they might see the way I hit my forward. They say, my God, if you used your driver, you could like crush this course, you know. But by not even having it in my bag, you know, I might be, people look at me like, you're kind of weird. I say, yeah, well, my parents told me not to use the driver. You listen to your parents? Yeah. Well, that's kind of weird, you know. Well, I'm doing a 1-year intensive, so I committed to it. See, so by committing to an intensive, that's the excuse. It's the excuse. It takes you off the hook. So I'm not saying anybody needs to commit to an intensive. There's no opting in or not opting in. You just do the best you can. Okay, you just do the best you can. And just watch as much as you can and listen as much as you can and just spend time with the materials I make available to you. Just do it. You know, don't listen to that teenage voice in your head so much. Yeah, listen to it a little bit. Because I know that superficially everybody in the world has to put on this front. Like, yeah, we're down with the ego's thing. You know, we're going to work it that way. Because pressure is too much for everybody. I understand that. But kind of secretly, have a kind of a secret preteen life still going on, right? Where secretly you're kind of paying attention, you know, to this, to 18. So don't be too loyal to 217, all right? Put up the front, that's fine. Everybody will put up a front. But also, on the side, be that wise preteen that says, you know what? I think being a zero ager is where I'm really at, where it's really at. Being a zero ager is where it's really at. So I'm going to start easing back towards that. So, for example, golf. I'm out on a golf course and I'm just absolutely crushing it with a four wood. But and guys will be saying like, "Wow, if you hit driver, man, you'd be something else." I said, "Well, you know, I'm following the instructions of the intensive. I'm on this my path right now." And you know, they'll shrug and kind of, okay. If you're okay with it, I'm okay with it. That's pretty much, I've found that pretty much that's the way it is, okay? Is if you're okay with it, other people would just say, well, okay, you're okay, that's okay. I'm okay that you're okay. Interesting. They might say, well, that's interesting. You know, there are different attitudes of edge to things, but I have found that people have not bothered me because, as I have said, the world set me free. So people do not harass me, really. They might be a little, you know, like grumpy about it, you know. Some are a little grumpy about my attitude. And say, hey, come on, be a teenager. It's lots of fun. Say, no, not this year. Not this year. I'm dedicated to being a preteen this year. Intensive. Preteen intensive this year, folks. It's a preteen intensive. No driver. And the wise, like the wise parents would tell a preteen, don't hit driver. You're hitting a five wood. I'm not going to allow you to have a driver. Good coaches do that. They tell their kids, no, I'm not even allowing you to do this. Like, yeah, it's true. Those are the wise parents. And you know what? 12-year-olds will still listen to them. Teenagers won't listen anymore. They'll say, no, Dad, you're stupid. And they'll borrow their friend's driver, you know, say, okay, Dad, I'm not using my driver now in the course. Hey, can I use your driver? Oh, great. And then there it goes. That's a teenager. They're disobedient. Whereas a preteen, they'll say, no, my dad and mom told me I can't use driver, you know, yet, so I'm not going to. That's an obedient. And you can tell the difference, right? To obedient child and a non-obedient one, you know, you can tell the difference, right? It's very obvious. So I'm an obedient preteen at this point, right? For this year. So that just like, wow. So wowish to come up with that. It's just, I trust the Dharma Kings will block the panic for me. And they're going to have to do a lot of work on this one. For sure. It's a big commitment I made, you know, a year like this to skip the whole year. And to forego enlightenment in this year. You know, it's huge. For them, it's huge too. I mean, that's their goal for me. That was their goal for me. And so we reached the goal. We succeeded. So, you know, it must be a big deal for them. A really big deal. And so I'll find out how it goes. For me, I just have to take it in stride and keep my head down and be humble. Yesterday, I really just was walking. I had to intentionally put my head down as I walked. Because it was very humiliating for me, my circumstances. I'm here, you know, on the day before, everyone else is off work. Then no one's working Saturday, the day before New Year's. Nobody was working. Almost no one. The grocery store clerks were, and I thanked them for it. Yes, you know, they were like really bothered by it too. Like they're kind of humiliated. Like everybody else is off, and we have to work. And I said, "You guys are the best," you know. And they looked at me and they said, "Wow, thank you," because they realized somebody, you know, recognized them in some way. You know, they appreciated it. It was appreciated. Had a good attitude. But I was walking with my head down because I'm having to do this really terrible hard work just to try to pay bills, stay afloat, not drown, you know. And on a day when most people are out of town on vacation, everybody's off, and here I am having to do this. And it's like, wow, this is, I said, my juicery, this is really rough. It's really tough. But I said, I'm doing it, and I'll stay humble. And I really walking, I put my head down, and I don't want to look at anybody, you know. Just let me just do it. Don't let any teenagers get a hold of me and say, "Hey, why don't you play hooky?" I said, "No, I got to do this." Now, people in the course might offer me to use their drivers. "Hey, why don't you use it?" No. I'm in this intensive, 1 year intensive. I'll just say my pro suggested this. My Dharma King pro suggested is gave me this instruction to follow. So I'm following it, and then we'll see. You know, we'll see how it goes. Maybe next time I see you, I'll use your driver or whatever. Because guys will say, "Wow, you just crushed it with a four. Are you kidding me? Man, here, try this driver. I want to see how far you can hit it." Like that. That's a teenage attitude, isn't it? "I want to see how far you can hit it." Yeah, I said, "Yeah, well, I'll hit it in the lake." You know, and they say, "Wow, you know, man, you know, maybe. Why don't gamble?" Well, it's not a time to gamble. I'm working on easement of the round. I want that feeling of like, I got this round. Before I even start, I've already got this round. I've already got it. That's a Tiger Woods attitude. He already knew before he even started the round what he was going to shoot. He already had it on his card. It was done. Before he even started, it was already done. He was that good. He knew, "So I'm going to shoot a 65 today. For sure. No problem. It's already done." And then he'd just go out, and in his mind, he'd already done it. So it was easy for him. He had that kind of mental focus that in his mind he'd already accomplished it. And whereas the rest of the guys were trying to accomplish it. For him, no. It was already done. And then he'd do it on the number. He'd do it on the number. He'd say afterwards, "Well, I said I'm my mind, I'm gonna shoot a 65, and what'd you shoot?" "I'm 65, yeah. Won the US Open, yeah, no problem. I don't know, or something, whatever, the Masters." Oh, he's relaxed. He's relaxed out there. Because he already has this easement with it, with his game. It's all easy. And he's committed to not being stupid out there. Committed. You see, that's great mental focus and commitment. Okay? And it works. So if I want to fly like Tiger on the golf course, this is an analogy, you know, it's a wonderful analogy. I have to do what the Dharma Kings say and get this easement out there. Is develop this sense of easement, like trouble, what trouble? There's no trouble out on a golf course. Everybody's all worried about, there's troubles coming. Tiger is like saying, "You guys, you know, you talk about trouble, blah, blah, blah. There's no trouble out here for me. I'm not getting in any trouble. What are you talking about?" So he's not all worried, you know. He's all anxious and worried. You see these guys like grinding, you know. He's not grinding. He's just like, "There's no trouble on the golf course for me. It's easy." So the rest of the guys are trying to smash a driver 300. They hit in the lake. Tiger hits a 2-iron, you know, like 275 or something, right in the middle. Then, you know, he powers his iron shots right on the green, hit beautiful iron shot, it's easy par or birdie, whatever. The rest of the guys are double bogey, they lose the tournament. So he already knows he's not going to hit driver there. He already knows what his game plan is. He already knows it's easy for him. So he doesn't have all these fear thoughts flooding his mind, which pumps up the adrenaline too much, which gets them to try to swing too hard at the driver, which pushes the shot into the lake. You see, it's skill called skillful means. So that developing this easement, easing in to ultimate easement, is really the skillful way to do it. That's how I carried that really heavy, bulky item up the stairs. I found a way to ease my way up the stairs. I didn't try to power up it, you know, like hitting a driver, like power it up. I eased my way up, and it worked. I did it. The point was to get it up on the shelf. It's not how you did it, it's to get it there, and I got it there. Whereas if I tried to power my way up, I may have injured my knee and not been able to do it. Disaster. So I found a way to avoid disaster, get it done. You know, ultimately we need to get to zero age zero. And we will. But we got to ease into timelessness, ease into it. So we say, yeah, no problem. No problem here. There's no trouble for me at all. No trouble for me at all. So I'm excited. I'm excited about it. I'm fired up about it. You know, this is just like wow for me. It is a big wow. Oh my gosh. Wonderful wow. A wonderful wow. So I hope this video has been a wonderful wow for you. I don't want to freeze myself. It's really quite cold. I got these smart wool socks. Hopefully I give you some tips during the year. It's a possibility, you know, just lifestyle tips. I never get any feedback from anyone, but maybe I should just do it anyway. Because since it's in silent intensive, I'm not really going to be responding to feedback. So I could do it. It doesn't matter. But if you're watching, you know, maybe I can give some, you know, tips, like stuff that I come across that are like really, you know, helpful and useful. And I have these socks, smart wool socks. It's called smart wool. It cost $25. I got they were gifted for me. I think someone found them at any mountain. They found them any mountain. And they're really long. They go up all the way up my calf. They keep my calves warm, which is really good. They're very comfortable. So I love them. You put on a pair of socks. Sometimes you say, these aren't going to work that great. And other times you put them on and say, oh wow. These are going to be great, and they're great. Smart wool. It's called smart wool socks. So there's a tip right there to help you out for some comfort. I mean, I've got two knee braces now. I'm wearing two knee braces just to protect both knees because my left is starting to get, you know, feel a little like a little edgy. And so I'm going to try to, you know, protect my knees, get them well, get them strong. And those knee braces, I can tell you what those knee braces are too. I don't have the name on the tip of my tongue right now. They cost like $25. They're really good. They're really, really good. So, you know, protect your health. You're going to need a little support as you go through your dream of 217. Any kind of support I can give you is going to be helpful, actually, as far as, you know, your diet, exercise, diet, lifestyle. You just got to crush it for year 217. If you're going to go through, most everyone is going to go through 217 in this world, okay? I might be the only one who's not going through 217 on the planet, you know? It could be possible. There may be some who don't, but I'm one of the extremely few, let's put it that way, extremely few who are not going to go through 217. So the rest of you will go through it. So these lifestyle tips will be very, very helpful for you. It was very helpful for me in 2016 to get these lifestyle tips to help me get through it. So setting goals will be very important for you. Setting goals, yeah. A health goal, a weight goal, fitness goal, you know, various types of goals. How to block out the, you know, no TV goal, no movies goal, you know, block that. And you work at it. And so as you get, as you reach 218, where I already am, you'll feel comfortable there. You'll say, hey, I belong in 218. I belong in 218. I don't belong in 217. I belong in 218. And of course, at that point, you might feel like, you know what? I'm gonna listen to what the Dharma Kings say, you know, as far as time goes. Maybe I can start skipping some time also, right? You want to aim towards being able to skip some time, right? That's what it's all about. God's whole plan of salvation is to ease you into skipping time, more and more time, skipping more and more time. That's A Course in Miracles. It's all about training you how to skip time. And, you know, I've skipped a year. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. For right? It's really good, actually. It's excellent. Most excellent. Skip a year. Entire year. So when you get the 218, you may want to feel like, hey, you know what? Skipping time, I like that. I'm feeling more at ease with that because I spent a whole year getting at ease with someone who's already skipped an entire year. Very, very wowish, isn't it? Very wowish. If you want to leave a comment anywhere, you can just say, wow, that means you're with it. You're with it. Okay, that's our shorthand. That's our inside talk, of those. That's the meta talk that we use is wow. That's our meta talk, So those who get it, they say, just say, wow. That means secretly you get it. Whereas superficially, you have to put up a front for the world. That's totally understandable, right? You have to pretend like, yeah, I'm still slugging my way through. Yeah, I got to get through 217. Wow, there's going to be a lot of stuff, a lot of turmoil. But secretly, you're just saying, hey, wow, I'm working on skipping time too. This is great. I'm with that. I'm with that. I like it. I like it. I'm paying attention. I'm paying attention. So watching that 12-year-old carve those waves, I said, wow, that's good enough for me. I'd be happy with doing that. Yeah. Let me get comfortable with that. Let me get comfortable with that. I'd love to surf again, and surf that in that way, really. I don't know if that's going to happen. It'd have to be a chain of events that would make that possible. Like I'd have to be able to see again without, and I couldn't get water in my ears. My ears would have to get well. But if those two things happened, yeah, I'd like to try it. I just talked with somebody. He's like 65. He's still surfing from this area. He's still crushing it surfing, 65. So yeah, I could still surf again. I'm in getting in good enough shape where that's possible. But if I don't have my glasses on, I can't see anything. I'd be surfing blind. Of course, who was it? Was it Nick Irons or something like that? Was it Surf Ch Chapu blindfolded? He surfed it blindfolded. Yeah, he did. It's like, wow. Okay. Yeah, it was Andy Irons' brother. I think Nick Irons has surfed Chapu, the Tahitian wave, blindfolded. Very intense, heavy wave. Just an unbelievable heavy wave. That's pretty amazing. But my ear problem with swimmer's ear, I can't get water in my ear because it stays in there. I can't get it out. I've had that problem since I was about 18 years old. So I haven't been really had to stop going in water. I used to be like a fish. I really was like a fish, really. I mean, I could handle water conditions really well, like a dolphin. A lot of kids are that way. Teenagers, right? Or kids, even young kids, they're like fish. It's amazing, right? What they can do. They're not afraid of the water at all once they learn how to handle themselves properly. I did free diving. I could just, body surfing, river stuff, just everything. I love the water, and I could handle, just about anything. I've been out in all conditions in the ocean and in water, just in really very intense situations. I just enjoyed it, the intensity of it. Of course, as a preteen, I handle it better. Because as a teenager, I started getting in situations that were a little too dangerous, and it wasn't that much fun, actually. It's like, whoa. I was trying to prove myself, to the older guys. But I didn't really enjoy it. I said, it's stupid. Why are you doing it? And it's funny, talking to some of those guys now, they say, what we did was stupid. I wish it was really stupid. Why do we even do that? Because they were trying to prove themselves to the older guys. It was a whole chain of things, right? And I was like, wow, that's just stupid. I mean, you're just getting crushed. Why don't we search for some better waves that are, more conducive? Don't try to overdo it. Take the driver out of the bag, in other words. Stop trying to, you know, be a hero to the older guys, you know. I mean, like the 15-year-olds are trying to be heroes to the 20-year-olds, right? 20-year-olds are carving up these big ways. The 15-year-olds say, oh, I got to do that. And then the 12-year-olds look at the 15-year-olds and say, oh, I got to try to do what they're doing. So you get this whole chain of pressure, you know, that's coming at you. Whole chain of it, actually. So teenage years are very difficult as we try to, you know, prove ourselves to our elders. But now you have a whole different situation. You get to prove yourself to your youngers here, right? You get to prove that you can get comfortable with going towards being a zero ager. How cool is that? That's really cool. Talk about cool. That's ultra cool. Talk about hip. That's ultra hip. Ultra hip. It's a whole new era in hipness that we just entered right here. And I know that this has made some appear to be unhip who were previously viewed themselves as being, you know, ultra hip, because this is now even more ultra hip. But that's the price, you know, I got to pay. That's the way, you know, if there's grumbling, there's grumbling. You know, that's the way it is. Nobody likes to be, you know, hippies don't like to be seen to be unhip. Okay, let's put it that way. Having gone through that whole era, which I didn't want to go through, actually, I said, that's you're gambling. That's risky. Don't do it. Stupid. But you know, there's so much competition in who can be the hippest, you know, just so much competition. And, you know, to be one-upmanship, you know, you got unhipped. Someone else is more hip. It's like, oh, God, just like horrible, you know. Where are the drugs? Give me more drugs. I got to be more hip. Everybody's using drugs so they could be more hip. You know, they could be like the Maharishi or something. Like, the Maharishi is more hip than we are. You know, how can we be more hip than the Maharishi? Oh, well, drugs, you know. We can find a way. It's so competitive. It's a whole academic, capitalistic, you know, competitive situation of, like, we got to be better. we gotta win. So the Maharishi is coming from this long background of really, you know, Hinduism, of the whole guru business thing, and they're so at ease with it, you know, they really are. And so he was like so at ease with being successful at being this big shot guru that all the guru wannabes, you know, so hip, there's just this hip, you know, this ultimate hippie kind of, these gurus, like the ultimate hippies, the Tibetan gurus, the Hindu gurus, the Eastern gurus, to us, they're the ultimate hippies. And so, like, how can we be like that? But the thing is, they're already at ease with the easement of being this guru figure. And so, you know, we didn't have that. We didn't have it. And you can't get it just like that. So people turn to all sorts of, you know, fixations, unhealthy fixations that just messed them up. So we're not going to repeat that mistake, are we? So now I'm like even more hip than these hippie figures, these guru figures. I'm even more hip than that. See, that's what we need. That's what we need, because I'm connected with the Dharma Kings. That's even more hip. No, not now. Okay. Yeah, I'm okay. Okay.
All right.
So I'm even more hip than the hippies now. I'm a Dharma prince with Dharma King connections all the way up straight to Manjushri. So that gives us then this capacity to pivot away from this other stuff, you know, which just because the Easterners are at ease with the role of a guru business doesn't mean that they're truly enlightened or truly understand skillful means. It doesn't mean that at all. It's there's a lot of cultural stuff there also. There's tons of gurus in the East that are just, you know, they're just business people. That's their business, and they're not aware, you know, of the true skillful means and the zero ageness, and that there's no world at all. They're not Rama Maharshi, for instance. Rama Maharshi's the real deal. Okay, they're not even close. Yet they have this easement with being these, you know, authority figures. All right. So if you try to compete with that, you're going to get devastated. You're going to be devastated. But now you have a way to pivot away from that, because this is more hip than that. I'm more hip than they are at this point. They've been unhipped, so to speak. Not because I'm trying to unhip them. I'm perfectly happy with them being the way they are. That's fine. It's just that this is more hip. That's all there's to it. So I don't need to be this guru figure, you know. I don't need that. I don't need to have the long hair and the white robes and all this kind of stuff. It's not. I don't need it. It's not needed. I'm already more hip than that. I'm a 12-year-old with Dharma King, direct Dharma King connections and access. Already skipped a whole year of time. Okay, so that's. See, I already have the credentials. I don't need to compete. So that helps everyone else pivot away from that also, because ultimately we do need to go on to the next step, which is we need to start skipping time. Seriously. And I think 217 will drive that home to you, drive it home to you that, you know, you need to start skipping time as well. This is really important. So right now you may be on the fence, okay, with this, and you say, well, you know, skipping time, yeah, that sounds interesting, but not sure. But after 217, okay, you will say for sure, you'll say, wow, I have really got to start skipping time. That's enough. That's enough of time. I got. So why not prepare for that? Why not use 217 as a preparation for you to start skipping time in 218? Okay? Look at it that way. And I'm just helping you with that. Because I guarantee you, when you hit January 1st, 218, you will say, I've had enough of time. Thank you very much, but I've had enough of it. So I got to start skipping time now. It's very important. So I'll be there for you to support your skipping of time at that point, okay? Because I will have already skipped an entire year, so I'll know, you know, how to help you out with that. Because you might say, gee, I kind of want to skip 218. When you get to 18, you may say that. I want to skip 218. Thank you very much. And so I'll know how to do that, having already skipped a year. And I'll have that in the bank, money in the bank, okay? That's really hip, isn't it? Yes, it is. Okay, very great. Very great. That's it for this one.